shear stress in beams. Consider a simply supported beam carrying a concentrated load. The applied load produces two internal forces in the beam, a shear force and a bending moment. If we cut the beam at some arbitrary point, say, at point C, we can determine these internal forces. At the cut point, the internal bending moment is 40 kN, and the shear force is 20 kN. Here is a three-dimensional view of the beam segment. In a previous lecture, we showed how the bending moment, M, produces bending stress at the beam's cross-section. And we derived the equation for the bending stress. In this equation, sigma is the bending stress at a typical beam fiber. Y is the distance from the neutral axis to that fiber. And I is the moment of inertia of the beam's cross-section about the neutral axis. In this and the next few lectures, we are going to show how the shear force, V, produces shear stress, tau, across the beam's cross-section. More specifically, we are going to derive the equation for the shear stress in a typical beam. And we are going to show how the shear stress equation can be used for design purposes. The bending moment in a beam could be constant, or it could vary. Consider a segment of this beam. Since the bending moment in the beam does not change, no shear force develops in the segment. This is true since the mathematical relationship between the shear force and the bending moment can be written as or. So, the shear force can be viewed as the change in the bending moment in the segment. When there is no change in the bending moment, the shear force becomes zero. Now consider a slice of this beam. Let dx represent the width of the segment. If we refer to the change in the bending moment in the segment as dm, to maintain static equilibrium, a shear force must exist, such that the total moment acting on the segment equals zero. Or, this equation also shows that the shear force, V, is equal to dm dx. Suppose this is our beam segment. As you can see, the segment is subjected to a clockwise bending moment of m on the left side, and a counterclockwise moment of m plus dm on the right side. Also, there is a shear force of V on each side of the segment. The length of the segment is dx, and the thickness of the beam is t. We know that this bending moment creates a stress distribution on the right side of the segment, like this. And the stress distribution caused by this bending moment looks like this. Suppose we cut the beam segment along a horizontal surface, like this. The upper part of the beam segment can be viewed as a rectangular prism. This prism is situated at some distance from the neutral axis of the beam. Let's refer to the area of the prism along the cross-section of the beam as A star. Here is the bending stress distribution on the right side of the prism. And here is the stress distribution on the left side of the prism. Since sigma star is greater than sigma, the bending stress causes a larger horizontal force on the right side of the prism. That is, the sum of the forces in the horizontal direction shown here is not equal to zero. The prism is not in the state of static equilibrium. For the prism to be in the state of static equilibrium, therefore, there must be another horizontal force acting on the prism. Sure enough, a shear force exists on the surface of the cut plane. We can represent the shear force as shear stress, tau. Assuming a uniform stress distribution on the cut plane, the total shear force can be written as tau times t times dx. Therefore, the sum of the forces in the x direction can be written as This term represents the volume under the stress diagram on the left side of the prism. This term is the volume of the stress diagram on the right side of the prism. And this is the total horizontal force due to the shear stress, tau, acting on the cut plane. This equation simplifies to: solving the equation for tau, we get: since dm dx represents the shear force, V, we can rewrite this equation as: note that this integral expression represents the moment of area, A star, about the beam's neutral axis. Let's refer to it as Q. Therefore, we can write the shear stress along the cut plane as: let's summarize our findings so far. Suppose we have a beam subjected to a shear force. If we cut a small segment of the beam, like this, we can determine the shear stress on the horizontal cut plane using this equation. The shear stress, tau, here and here, is a function of V, the shear force acting on the beam's cross-section, T, the thickness of the beam, I, the moment of inertia of the entire cross-section of the beam about the neutral axis, and Q, the moment of this shaded area about the neutral axis. Interestingly, the shear stress on the plane of the beam's cross-section along this line is also equal to tau. Put it differently, this equation gives us the shear stress on this horizontal plane and on the vertical plane along this line. To see why this is the case, let us isolate an infinitesimal cube from the beam along this edge. We know the shear stress at the top of the cube. It is tau. Since the cube must be in a state of static equilibrium, the shear stress at the bottom surface of the cube must also be tau. Note that the sum of the two shear stresses equals zero. This shear stress pair, however, produces a counterclockwise moment. Hence, the shear stress needs to produce an additional clockwise moment for the sum of the moments acting at the cube to be zero. This additional moment is produced by an additional shear stress pair that acts on the sides of the cube, as shown here. Therefore, the shear stress acting on the cross-section of the beam here is tau. So, this analysis shows that the shear stress at a point is present in two orthogonal directions. The shear stress is present on both the vertical and horizontal planes. In summary, the shear stress acting across the cross-section of the beam at a specific distance from the neutral axis can be determined using this equation. Suppose we have a beam with a rectangular cross-section. The beam is subjected to a concentrated load of 100 kilonewtons. We can easily determine the maximum shear force in the beam. Here is the beam's shear diagram. The diagram tells us that the shear force reaches its maximum value of 100 kilonewtons in the overhang section of the beam. So, parallel to the beam's cross-section, we have a shear force of 100 kilonewtons. Suppose we wish to determine the shear stress acting on the surface of the beam's cross-section along this line. Here is our shear stress equation. V, the shear force, equals 100 kilonewtons. I, the moment of inertia of the beam's cross-section about the neutral axis, is: Q is the moment of this shaded area about the neutral axis. The shaded area equals 0.2 times 0.1. The distance from the center of the area to the neutral axis is 0.15 meters. Substituting these values in the shear stress equation, we get: that is, the shear stress along this line equals 1,406 kilonewtons per square meter. Next, Let us calculate the shear stress along the neutral axis. The only term in the shear stress equation that needs to be recalculated is Q, the moment of this shaded area about the neutral axis. Q becomes 0.004 cubic meters, which results in a shear stress of 1874.4 kilonewtons per squared meter. As we just demonstrated, the shear stress varies across the beam's cross-section. To better understand this change in the shear stress, we can graph it along the vertical axis. A typical horizontal line across the cross-section of the beam is located at a distance, y, from the neutral axis. To calculate the shear stress along this line, we need to determine the moment of this shaded area about the neutral axis. The area equals the distance from the center of the area to the neutral axis, labeled D, equals. Therefore, Q can be written as a function of Y, as shown here. Consequently, tau, the shear stress, can be written as a quadratic equation. From this equation, we can conclude that tau attains its maximum value when Y is zero. That is, the maximum shear stress takes place along the neutral axis. Here is the graph of the shear stress equation. We can clearly see that in the vertical direction, shear changes parabolically across the beam's cross-section. Consider a simply supported beam subjected to a uniformly distributed load. The cross-section of the beam is I-shaped, as shown here. The moment of inertia of the section about the neutral axis is. We wish to determine the maximum magnitude of the distributed load, W, that the beam can hold without any shear failure. The shear strength of the material, structural steel, is assumed to be 20 ksi. The shear force in this beam reaches its maximum value near the supports. Let us assume that the maximum shear value equals the magnitude of the support reactions, 10W. The stress condition that needs to be satisfied can be written as or. We know that the maximum shear stress in the beam develops along the neutral axis. T, the thickness of the cross-section at the neutral axis, equals 1.16 inches. The shear stress equation can be written as Q is the moment of this colored region of the cross-section about the neutral axis. To calculate Q, we can divide the target area into two rectangular areas. Area 1 is the area of the flange of the section. This area equals 33.65 squared inches. The distance from the center of area 1 to the neutral axis is 16.73 inches. Therefore, Q1 equals. Area 2 is half the area of the web of the cross section. This area equals 18.19 squared inches. The distance from the center of area 2 to the neutral axis is 7.84 inches. Therefore, Q2 equals. Adding Q1 to Q2, we get Q. Substituting Q in this equation, we get or. This is the maximum shear force that the beam can be subjected to. Therefore, the maximum distributed load that the beam can support has a magnitude of 72 kips per foot. We will continue this discussion in the next lecture.